I don't know whether you can see that.
You'll get a close-up later on.
Well, that's a little gold pin designed by Sir Basil Goulding in his own inimitable way. It's made of gold, and it is like it's a 9 one way round and then a 9 backwards. And it's to celebrate the fact that the Contemporary Irish Art Society would be composed of 99 people. The syndicate of 99 that he said he was going to aim to get 99 people together as a syndicate to all put in some money and to buy these works by contemporary Irish artists.
In 1960s Ireland, a group of diverse individuals, including architects, business people, artists, academics and arts administrators, came together around a shared interest in and desire to support and promote contemporary Irish art and artists. The dynamo at the centre of the initiative was the charismatic figure of Basil Goulding. An initial group of 9 people formed the Contemporary Irish Art Society in 1962, with Basil Goulding as the first chairman.
Still the 60s we're talking about here, you know, censorship was still very much on the statute books and was actively used.
Books were being banned all over the place, had been for years, even innocuous kind of books, you know, that had no threat to anyone. But we had a self-censorship here in Ireland at that time on all cultural events.
A lot of people who were in the collecting mode were looking for James Arthur O'Connors and Barrett's, and they were looking for period pieces, older Irish art.
There was no way you could just set yourself up as a painter, as it were, and the School of Art was totally academic and pretty terrible place, really.
Certainly from an auction point of view, we just didn't sell the contemporary art at the time, partly to protect the artist's interests, because I felt if I put things up for auction, the public would not be interested. There'd be no money for us, no money for them. So they were sold by galleries, and even the galleries found it very difficult to sell.
I think probably in the sort of 50s and 60s in Ireland and into the 70s, really art, the purchasing of art was a terribly elitist thing. There were a very, very small group of wealthy people who patronised the arts and bought paintings. And it's only in the last 20 years, I think, that the thing has mushroomed and grown.
The fear of the middle classes, like, was that their sons or daughters would end up as artists and commit suicide like Van Gogh, you know. This was the kind of fearful kind of territory. So that was a kind of repressive atmosphere that I grew up in. You know.
I became an artist after I'd tried nearly everything else, I suppose. I studied architecture. I worked for a time as a professional musician. I worked as an engineering draftsman. I worked as a postman. God, I tried nearly everything.
It was very hard to get a show in a gallery because there were only 2 galleries. And I mean, they formed their stables In the 50s, I suppose, really.
The real places for exhibiting at the top level was the Hendrix and the Dawson Gallery. And it was very difficult for a young artist to break into that.
At that stage in the mid-60s, one had begun to feel a little bit excluded because somehow or other, the figurative modernists didn't fit in.
With the one thing and another, with the business of, as I say, we used to put shows on in holes in the wall. We kept on showing, and it became obvious that we weren't going to go away.
From the public point of view, there was very little opportunity for the public to see works, and I think this is one of the reasons why the Contemporary Irish Arts Society emerged, why people started to buy work for the Municipal Gallery at that time, because there was a huge idealism around from a small group of people.
You know, there was good art being made by a number of good contemporary Irish artists, but they weren't able to sell it. There were very limited opportunities to show it, and really, it wasn't a very happy situation for artists to be in. And then the Contemporary Irish Art Society appeared into the middle of all of that and immediately gave leadership by suggesting that they should encourage the making of contemporary art by buying good quality work and donating it to public institutions where it could be seen publicly.
During the Second World War, for example, the White Stag Group was established, and they were mostly foreign artists who came to Dublin through Britain, I suppose, to escape the war and all the rest of it, as a lot of artists tried to do. In Europe, they got away, you know.
They appeared in Dublin in the sort of middle of 1940, I think, and that they were working away and had studios in Baggot Street, and they had an exhibition in one of their apartments on the drawing room floor.
Out of that came the living art. But before that you had from 1823 or 1825, whatever, you had the Academy. And the Academy at that stage had it become a bit stultified, you know. And the living art then was an alternative, a modernist alternative.
Jellett was the first president of the Living Art, and she died before the first exhibition, actually. And then Norman McGuinness became the president of the Living Art then.
It was modern for the time because, again, you know, there was the Academy was also happening, and it was very conservative, or perceived to be very conservative, and so the Irish Exhibition of Living Art was mainly younger artists. There would be Le Brocque would be in it, Patrick Scott, Nora McGuinness, Jerry Dillon. A lot of them would be figurative, but they were figurative in a contemporary way. And it was also an abstraction that was sort of developing out of the English abstract expressionist, you know, around Roger Hilton and the St. Ives people. My big memory of that time, in fact, is the excitement of artists submitting work, waiting to be accepted, getting the note through the letterbox, say one was accepted, two was accepted, or none was accepted, or whatever. And the kind of sort of phone calls that would take place between artists. So that was a huge event in the whole contemporary calendar of that time.
I was going to the College of Art as a night student all during from the mid-50s up to 1960, 61. And there I met people like Charlie Cullen and the chap from Galway, Joe Dolan, Tig McSweeney, who was a Cork. They were from all over the place.
I distinctly remember meeting Charlie Cullen. He was a quiet lad, but he was tremendously talented. I was lucky enough also to come across James McKenna, who had just come back to do a postgraduate year.
But we all had a similar idea. We wanted to do something in the visual arts. And then a group of kind of expatriates came back from Spain, including Michael Caine, Ronnie Drew, and there was a poet called Joe Hackett. A very interesting group of people. And for the first time I heard names like Camus and Sartre and all. They were the fashionable writers in the French tradition, if you like it. So all that came together in the back lounge of Donoghue's pub. And Donoghue started out as a kind of a late night drinking place after the College of Art closed. And the architects like Eamon O'Doherty, John Bloomer and people like that used to come in. And we all got together. So a group, a nucleus of people formed at that stage.
The Contemporary Irish Art Society was formed in 1962 because of a lack of support for artists and a lack of funding for galleries.
The only public gallery in Dublin was the Municipal Gallery, now called the Hugh Lane, and they had no funds and they didn't have much interest at that time in contemporary practice until James White was appointed in the early 60s, and that's when things started to change.
I think pioneers like Leo Smith in the Dawson Gallery were very good introducing to his more conservative, well-to-do clients abstract art. So people like Basil Goulding and collectors like that, Gordon Lambert, were very important in encouraging and patronising artists at that time and building up collections.
Smith was the one really who was my dealer. You know, he'd set up his own gallery. He rang me up one day after I'd left in a painting and he said Stanley Moss was in today and he likes that painting you left in very much. He's come up with an idea that he would get some friends, business friends, to join in with him to buy it and present it to the Hugh Lane. I rang him back and said, if a group of people is being formed to buy this painting, why can't they buy more paintings for the gallery?
Well, the nine got together, and as a result of Stanley Moss' desire to buy the painting, they all put a £10 in the hat, so the story goes, and the painting was then given to the municipal. We think at the behest of James White, its then director.
So I said, I'll write to the Tate Gallery and I'll get the details of the Friends of the Tate. And I'll also write to the CAS, which is the Contemporary Art Society. The Tate's a good arrangement for the Tate, but I said, really, we should have something like the CAS here, which can buy paintings and give them to other galleries. So anyhow, they examined both brochures and they decided to form the CAS. And that was how it started.
And then the original nine decided to meet, and I think it all happened quite informally, that they just met and discussed and asked Basil Goulding to chair a sort of committee, and they decided to call a Contemporary Irish Art Society.
The real benefit, of course, was the work was going into the public domain, so that you had support for artists going hand in hand with a public education exercise.
We have 37 works in total, and just to give you an idea, 10 of the works are being lent to this exhibition.
I think what's amazing is that the first 10 or so works that they bought in 1962-63 were inspired. You know, they bought an early William Scott. William Scott was only beginning to really become recognised internationally. You know, they really showed quite astonishing, I think, wisdom in their early selection. And they also managed to buy this work, 10 works by really amazingly good Irish artists, for, I suspect, very little money.
All the paintings were given that they purchased between 1962 and 1973 were given to the municipal. I think it's important that annually these paintings were bought, so it's a record not only of the artists, but of a whole time, a whole decade, a history of a decade in the buying.
And then I think with the support of the Contemporary Irish Art Society, the City Council was persuaded as to the validity and the importance of the public institutions supporting contemporary art.
Well, it became clear that if the municipal was getting a grant, it was necessary to spread our wings, so to speak. And then the Council of Nine decided to give works to other galleries, to hospitals and to schools.
Well, very few artists were able to survive on the income from their artistic work. The majority of them had to have other employment. So life as a career as a visual artist in Ireland in the 60s was very challenging economically.
I did a certain amount of work around Dublin, like labouring type of work, very low paid stuff. And then I went to London with some friends of mine. I didn't want another profession, so I was doing very badly paid jobs, of which there was plenty of them in London, but they were all badly paid. I had met a good few of people that I continue to know, Irish painters over there, including Michael Caine, John Kelly, Charlie Cullen, John Bean. After a while we decided we were going to return, and the way we put it was, not going to let them get away with it. And at that time then, people began to return.
People who were simply trying to find a space to exhibit, you know, I think that was the main thrust, and to give out our message. And it was basically, I think if you analyze it now, it was an expressionist group of people. In fact, we formed a little club in the back of Donahue's, and we said, we'll drink for 6 days a week, and then the seventh day we'll paint, and we'll call ourselves the Depressionist School. there was all that guy. It was fun, you know, as well as everything else.
So they would have been figurative artists whose work was of a figurative nature, rather than what was seen to be trendy 60s work at the time.
It became necessary then to form groups, to think in terms of the collective, in order to get one's work on show at all, to find a gallery, some space in which you could hang pictures, and exploit a new factor on the scene, which was that the Arts Council was prepared to fund exhibitions like this. Modestly, but nonetheless, it was something. So group exhibitions became a thing in the 60s.
A lot of people don't know is that most of the exhibitions in Dublin in the 60s were actually Arts Council exhibitions. They may have been put on the Municipal Gallery at the time, but it was the Arts Council who were initiating them and bringing them in.
I think the most important group at that time was formed by these people. Like, there was Noel Sheridan, Camille Souter. They wanted to have their own way of saying things. Barry Cook was part of a very, very important people, right, in terms of what's happened to date. And that was the Independent Artist, and that's how it was founded in about 1960.
It wasn't polite to be ideological in art, but it became very apparent to us as figurative modernists in the 60s that we weren't welcome in either camp. We weren't doing the sort of designy, semi-abstract that was favoured in the living art, and we weren't doing the heavy, old-fashioned portrait and still life thing that would have done us good in the RHA. So it became necessary to create another forum, and we saw the Independent Artists as being the way in which to do that.
The first exhibitions were held in the Building Centre in Baggot Street in Dublin. And James McKenna called it Mickey Scott's Cellar because it was an architectural building as well. And then it expanded and it virtually took over the Municipal Gallery.
Naturally enough, they give the living art their due. They copped on and started inviting people from the Independents because it's the first time they were seen.
Yes, I remember the Independents. I think they really found the living art was a bit cliquish, and I don't know, but some of them went on showing at the living art as well, you know.
I was associated with the setting up of the Project Art Centre, which was basically artists who had no gallery, had no opportunities to show, and therefore very few opportunities to access the market for art, little though it was.
The group that I was associated with, the Independent Artists and Group 65 and the project in the early days, had to do with looking for an Irish cultural identity independent of either provincialism or internationalism. And somewhere in between, we were trying to find our feet, you know.
When I began in the late 60s, there was a whole raft of younger artists coming on stream. And a lot of them, their experience certainly was not rural. They either came from Dublin or Cork, or the major urban centres. And there was a general feeling that everything was possible then. You probably remember the student rebellion in May in 68 in France. Change seemed possible, etc. You have to set that against chronic underdevelopment in Ireland.
People like Bobby Balla, like Tim Goulding, even Cecil King, who was perhaps older in age, but in terms of sensibility, was more connected to this modern group who were looking across the water. They were looking to what was happening in the US, and it was really a more international art with a much more international flavor. These were artists that were a little more hard edge, a little more abstract, or they looked toward pop art, some of them, but very much more international and less painterly, less atmospheric, a little edgier, and I think very much of their time.
So I became, I suppose, Ireland's first pop artist. There are those who said I was Ireland's only pop artist, but that's something else.
1967, Rusk, the first Rusk happened, and that was another mind-blowing experience, you know. And that again came out of the people in the Rusk Committee were Michael Scott, Cecil King, Dorothy Walker, and Cruikshank. I mean, they were the core art workers. I mean, they did all the work. It was all voluntary. You have no idea the amount of work these people did voluntarily.
Their involvement in Rusk came out of their involvement in the Contemporary Irish Art Society. That was the first society, and they became known initially through their collective links to that, as well as, of course, their separate links or their separate profile altogether as businessmen and as, leaders in the community in one way or another.
I remember the RUSC because I was the one that designed the first RUSC in the RDS. It was an idea thought up by Michael Scott and James Johnson Sweeney. No young people were seeing any art on the international scene. This was to bring work from the universe, as it were, you know.
A huge exhibition out in the RDS of abstract art. And that brought people's attention to this kind of art. A lot of Irish people, even well-educated ones, had never seen it before.
It was very controversial as well, because they chose not to have any Irish artists in it. This was, again, being aware that there was no Museum of Contemporary Art in the country, so as to bring art from outside in. The feeling was that people had an opportunity to see Irish art, they didn't have an opportunity to see enough international art, and therefore RUSC was concentrating just bringing art in, and ally it to ancient Irish art. Very controversial. An awful lot of artists are very unhappy.
It meant that the sort of 10 days leading up to the opening of the RUSC, it was in the headlines every day, so it got the most fantastic publicity for the wrong reasons, really.
So whereas the general public would have been very clear that they appreciated the RUSC initiative, and certainly there's no denying the huge impact RUSC had on the education of public awareness, public taste in the whole area of modern art. Irish artists in Dublin at the time, felt greatly aggrieved that their work wasn't going to be on display.
So, you know, it went on 71, again, there were no Irish artists, and I think the first time there were Irish artists was 77, in the third RUSC, I think, or maybe the fourth even, in 1980. But the first two certainly had no, and they were extraordinarily important events.
And as Ireland became stronger and economically more vibrant, as you said, buildings went up and companies began to have more money to spend on wonderful premises and on artwork to embellish that. I think also that there was gradually more and more awareness.
The big change, I think, came in the mid-70s or a little later, you know, particularly when the banks started building big headquarters, and they, I think through the prodding probably of their architects or whatever, started to build up collections.
A lot of the people of my generation who had come out of college at around the same time had gone abroad like I had done and come back around about the same time within those couple of years. And there was a great buzz, a great deal of enthusiasm, and even though there was no structure in place as such, there was the willingness to begin group studios or found your own studio, to begin exhibiting, and there was a great deal of support there for that.
I say in the early 70s, the Arts Council was reformed in 1973, that the whole thrust, the pro-artist, the pro-creative artist approach of the Arts Council then came to the fore in the mid to late 70s.
The 1970s also saw major developments in third-level art education. The number and range of people studying visual arts increased greatly. This expansion from 1975 onwards was accompanied by the setting up of the National Council for Educational Awards, the NCEA, which formalised art education awards, leading to BAs in arts education for the first time.
It sounds like a cliche, but Dublin was smaller then. And most people in the art world knew one another. And a group like the Contemporary Irish Art Society was founded by people who were massively enthusiastic about the arts and had the confidence to support younger artists.
Gordon Lambert and Basil Goulding were on the council of the IMI. And the IMI, this building was built in 72, 73. We moved into it in 1974. And they were both on the council, and they took a great interest in the building, of course. And very soon they saw a way of using the building as a way of promoting art, because there were at least 300 people coming through this building every day on courses. And so they started hanging their purchases on the walls, in between having exhibitions and giving donations. So there was a never-changing exhibition here in the building.
We had a very big piece of work that we'd purchased, which I suppose was semi-abstract, but very highly coloured. And it was very difficult to find anywhere to put it. So we put it in the canteen of the IMI. And we had some objections. We don't want that in our canteen. We were not consulted, and this sort of thing. Well, about 5 years later, we were going to donate it to another source who actually had the space and wanted to have it. And we were going to take it out. And I said, you can't take that out. That's ours. And we thought, success.
The starting point, like a lot of companies, was the building of a new corporate headquarters. And that, I mean, that pattern repeats itself again and again, not only in Ireland, but in every country in the world, that a company gets this brilliant new space and lots of bare walls, and they want to put art in it.
Michael Carroll and a few others, Dermot Egan, who were very fond of contemporary Irish art, and of course Tony O'Malley had worked in the bank. But it wasn't until they appointed Frances Rouen about 1979 or 1980 that she formally put their collection on a sound basis. And I know Dermot Egan and the friends of AIB came out to my house and looked at my collection before they really got going on their own collection.
Just before we started collecting, we bought it much after that, but I was so glad to get it because I had seen it when it was in Rusk originally. And it sums up the whole dilemma of the role in the 70s that the modern artist faced. And it's Bala asking, what is the role of a contemporary artist?
The Bank of Ireland already had a collection, but they ran out of steam about in the 80s and 90s. But despite that, I think they've started going again. A lot of new corporates came along then, partly through our membership of our society.
So because you had a core group of people who had a passion for Irish art, they then were followed by lots and lots and lots more people who would come, become involved, visit exhibitions, be in regular contact with galleries and so forth. So for an Irish artist, that was enormously encouraging.
But they also planted little seeds of modern art in places like, I remember, in UCD.
We also organised exhibitions from time to time. We did a wonderful exhibition, I think, in London in 1980 during the Sense of Ireland Festival of Irish Art. And that was of young artists, most of which went to University College Dublin afterwards. We thought it was important that the art should get out and be seen by a wider public, and in the case of UCD and Trinity and places like that, by a young audience.
And the fascinating thing about that is UCD had no purchasing grant. So again, like the CAS had done for the municipal, they gave it to the UCD on the condition that they would have a purchasing grant.
One was aware also that they were making important donations to places. They did make donations, of course, to art galleries to supplement whatever meagre budgets they had, and a lot of them were not only meagre, they were probably non-existent.
The Contemporary Irish Art Society doesn't focus in its collecting on regions. They collect what's interesting and what's excellent, but in dispersing then the fruits of their collecting endeavours around to different museums, they increase the spread and diversity of regional collections. I suppose I would describe the Crawford as a regional collection.
Yeah, I've been here 5 years, and one of the first things that came in would be Tony McGuinness, the sort of the Irish art mover, arrived and he said, I have some things for you from CIS, and that was literally my introduction. And so these things came off the truck, and it was after the follow-on call of explaining what they were, and I was looking through them. So for me it was like a little treasure trove, and it was a feeling that one's budget in working with local authority is modest and you collect in a variety of ways, but by and large it's that sense of that it provides a little bit of energy when something arrives out of the blue, or sometimes you can go to the CIS and say, there's a particular piece in a particular gallery, what are the funds like, would that be possible? But it's really about just keeping that flow going.
We have been lucky to have received about 20 works from the Society over the years, and it really adds to the wealth of the collection, which is very rich in its holdings. It has been done with a sensitivity, I think, to what we've already been collecting. So it's adding to that collection and expanding the 20th century holdings.
We had the policy to buy good contemporary works of Irish art, but we didn't have any wish to store them. I mean, the obvious place to put them out on public display. So we gave them to Kilkenny Art Gallery Society, we gave them to Limerick Art Gallery, but then hospital like St. James's and the hospice in Donnybrook came seeking works of art, and we were delighted to donate them there as well.
The other important thing is the placing of those works. They've been instrumental in putting artworks in hospitals, other educational institutions, where previously there was no art at all. And often those very institutions then get used to having art in their places and set up an arts committee and start purchasing artworks themselves for their institutions.
The art collection in here in the Royal Hospital Donnybrook is quite unique, but it has its origins in the shared membership of the Friends of this hospital and the CIAS of Patricia McHugh, who was herself an appreciator of modern art.
I found the place very grim. You know, high ceilings and really grim. And you would come out of it depressed.
It was supported by funds from an initiative of the Friends here, which was a clothes shop, which was generating a small income for the benefit of the patients.
I started going to Friends. Gordon Lambert was really great, and Carmel Mooney. They were all pushing me and saying, "You're doing great." So that's how it all started.
She was encouraged by the chairman of the CIAS, Gordon Lambert, and also by Cecil King, the artist. As a beginning, the CIAS presented the hospital here with five works of art.
If you had been a patient here and sat looking at bare walls, but now they've lowered the ceilings, they're hanging plants, they put in new floors, and they're paintings on the wall. And we have paintings, and it makes such a difference.
The Royal Hospital Donnybrook was also home to a number of artists in their later years, including Patrick Collins, Richard Kingston, and Eric Patton.
This has always been accepted and known through the history. Art has a beneficial healing qualities in that. The whole project of is more than just putting pictures on the wall. It is a whole concept of philosophy. I compare it to the landscaping of around the hospital, of the gardens and the grounds. And what we are doing is we are doing a form of landscaping inside the hospital.
I think the Contemporary Irish Art Society was very important in the last 30, 40 years, in fact since they were founded, because they collected Irish art and thereby encouraged contemporary Irish artists at a time when there were very few formal institutional opportunities for that to happen. There was no museum of contemporary Irish art, no national collecting institution. And I mean, if I could talk of one collector in particular who was very actively involved in the Contemporary Irish Art Society, of course I'd have to mention Gordon Lambert. He was president or chairman of the society for quite a period of time. He was a very, very active collector. But he would also have just always acted as an ambassador for contemporary art, so that, you know, he was invited to be the first Irish person ever to be a member of the International Council of MoMA. So, you know, there's a direct chain of events where, you know, first he was in the Contemporary Irish Art Society, then arising out of that, he's in the International Council of MoMA, and then arising out of that, he's lobbying for a Museum of Modern Art in Ireland. So he had that history on the one hand, and then his involvement with the artists is full of deeply personal stories. Many of the artists will tell you that they'd write to Gordon and say, look, I'm really in trouble. Is there any chance you'd come to the studio and see if there's something you can buy? And quite often I know he did that.
I think that people respected him too on the business end because he was a success in terms of his business career. And I think that at that time there was more a divide between the arts people and the business people. Now, less so.
Only a small coterie of people loved art, were interested in it, used to follow it. That has grown exponentially. Now you can go to an art exhibition in Dublin and there might be 300 people, 400 people.
But I think what's happened too for Irish artists is that they're very comfortable in the world. They have spent time abroad, they've travelled, and they come back to reinvigorate their own climate of art making.
The whole Celtic Tiger thing had an inevitable influence because you had a lot more money. And a lot of galleries responded to the fact that there were buyers out there ready to buy. There were a lot of younger buyers. So that changed things a lot. Also, people like John De Vere White, when he started the De Vere's auctions, I think he was trying to carve a little niche, a secondhand niche, for modern works.
Art is not a commodity. I mean, if your heart isn't in it, and that what you're buying isn't going to give you pleasure, well then, you know, I just think you deserve to become a cropper. But I think if people develop their eye and they pay attention to what, you know, market trends, I think if you take a long-term view, and I would say a long-term view, 10 years, I think generally over 10-year period, if you buy astutely, I think Irish art, has proven and will continue to prove to be a reasonably sound investment. And when I show you people this painting, which I think is a very sophisticated painting, I mean, Dylan, as you know, was, you know, he had no formal training. But I mean, this painting was sold, I'm just looking here, was sold in 1959 in the RHA for £30. And we'd be confident of getting somewhere between 50 and 70,000 euros. So if you'd held that since 1959, you'd have got a reasonable return on your money.
The whole society had to turn itself around in a very short time. You know, we leapt from, as Chesterton said about the United States, it went from a primitive society into a decadent society without any intervening civilization period in between. We were a bit like that between 1960, I think, and 2000, let's put it that way.
So it's all utterly, utterly changed, and greatly for the better, but I'm still in my hideout here, ploughing my lonely furrow, so I don't go out to get mixed in too much now.
As I used to say, until I became one of the establishment, I used to think that there were a terrible elitist crowd of gobdaws who were forever up their own arses. And then when I became part of the establishment, I realised it was absolutely true. So. Thank you.